Greetings. I don't go into far. I have a series of videos, you could say, that are all interconnected. And Shabbat Shalom, Sembet Salam, being that today is still, it's still Shabbat time here in the West Coast, Southern California. This week's Torah portion is Leviticus chapter 30. I'm going to start off in Genesis. It's not part of the studies in the actual, in our chart. The Lion of Judah, Society, Sabbath, Torah portion. It's not on here, but it relates. And I guess I'll title these videos, Holiness to the Lord and Law or something like that. Because Leviticus is the law of Ayanai Rastafari. And first of all, well, speaking of movement, Exodus, we're going to keep moving. We're going to do our best. I'd like to give thanks to some sisters have been really supportive and have contacted some brethren, and I give thanks. And I don't know, I was able to receive a lot of information, so let's get on it. But first, I'd like to say, I don't know a whole lot. I just want to, I guess, assist Rasayadanis. And if anything, direct anyone watching to a more higher level of education, which would be the Ethiopian World Net on the YouTubes. And if you'd like, visit www.lojsociety.org. So that being said, okay, actually, I'd like to share a little something. It's a rough draft of, but this is what's coming along. Of the book. So now it's looking more like a book. Although it's going to be hardcover and the pages are going to be one in back of the other, but just so you can get an idea of what kind of progress we're doing. From here on, I think things might be delayed because I don't have a whole lot of money, to be honest. But who cares? I mean, that's beside the point. Now okay, I want to address another matter. I put out a video warning to Rastafari, and I just want to, if you open your scriptures to Matthew chapter 24 and verse 24, I want to kind of clarify, because a brother was kind enough to kind of, I guess, point out that the message might not have been that clear. And so it is my intention to clear it up. See, what I was speaking about was regarding these people that come along with really, really high knowledge, high levels of knowledge, and are accurate, and they'll admit that the Bible is true, but that it's only metaphorically, or not to take it literally, and that Jesus Christos was never a character. And so they do present like very, very, very accurate and advanced information, but they reject the humanity and the literal aspect of scripture. And I put out that warning. My intention was for those that aren't grounded or firmly grounded to not be discouraged, because I know for a fact that can be discouraging, because these people present a lot of information that compel a good argument, so they think. But let I and I remember that I'm not saying they do it on purpose or anything, but some do, some don't, but it's not given to them. See, they don't know the truth of His Imperial Majesty. And so that's the only thing, you know, they're on the right track as far as information, but it's not been given to them to receive the truth of Jesus, His humanity, and His Father. And so I just wanted to encourage, you know, beginners. Well, I myself am a beginner, but maybe to those less fortunate, I guess, to increase groundation, to be, look out for those things, because, like I said, Matthew chapter 24 will pretty much explain it. So, chapter 24, verse 24, it reads, "For there shall arise false Christ and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect." And if I could help avoid deceiving potential electee, then my mission as far as that, releasing that video, would have been completed. It's all, I mean, these people will claim to be Christ in the sense of anointed, chosen to represent certain information as true, but, and prophets, but in reality, if possible, they shall deceive the very elect. And I'm not saying intentionally, but maybe it just wasn't given to them by our Father, like it was to us. Now, behold, I'm going to continue, verse 25. "Behold, I have told you before, wherefore, if they shall say to you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not. For as the lightning cometh out of the east, and shineth every, even to the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." So maybe people in the east won't necessarily get it, but us in the west have an opportunity to actually receive the light. Now, verse 28, "For whensoever the carcass is, there will the angels be gathered together." Now I'm going to stop there. The carcass, wherever the carcass, wheresoever the carcass is, there will be the angels gathered together. Wherever the corporation is, corpse, dead body, or a body, and nation, like nation, if break it down from a Latin perspective, it comes down to birth, nació, like el nació, he, well, I can't directly translate it, but it would be like, he was born, and so born dead. And I can't recall, but there's something to that. So, just interesting. I mean, I'm not saying that that is what I claim to be, but it's interesting to know wherever the carcass or the corporations are, there will the angels be gathered. So now let us, that completes that. And let us go to Genesis. I'm not going to go into great detail. There's so much I want to cover. And I want to keep these videos short as possible, because I know all the eyes have busy schedules, and plus it makes it easier to upload. I don't have very good, I guess, technical, or whatever you want to call that, computer. I don't have a fast computer. I actually need to update my user or whatever, but I'm having problems with that. So, Genesis chapter 8. Let's go to, this may seem like it has nothing to do, but it will. Like I said, it's not included in the Orit Nebab or Torah portion readings, the Rastafari Sabbath studies, but it I know it connects. Well, anyway, since I'm not going to go into that much great detail, also not to get off track like I always do, it's going to be up to the viewers to to kind of pay attention so that you can make connections that maybe I'll forget to connect, because every video that I'm going to do for this series is very much connected. So let's Genesis chapter 8. And God remembered Noah. Oh, stop right there. God remembered. Okay, later on when I do the part on Exodus, you're going to understand, because this is a memorial. God remembered. And it's a token, and I'll leave it at that. We'll make the connection later on. Now, and every living thing, and all the cattle that was with him in the ark. And God made a wind pass over the earth, a spirit, we could say, pass over. And the waters as assuaged. The fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained. Just interesting. It makes me laugh, I guess, because it reminds me of that one song, Make It Rain on These Woes or Hoes, like on these curses. But that's beside the point. Let me continue. Verse 3, and the waters returned from off the earth continually. And after the end of the 150 days, the waters were abated. 150 days. I can't remember, but that may have to do with casting the net on one side, and then Jesus tells the disciples or apostles at that time to try the other side, and I think in total they catch 150. I think it's 120 for... Oh, okay, that's... I'm getting off track already. Now, I'll continue. That the waters were abated, and the ark rested in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, upon the mountains of Ararat. Ararat. Now, the waters abated, that they diminished, they decreased. It became safer. And that's important. Keep note of that. And the ark rested. Once again, this is going to play effect into the Sabbath. This is obviously a Sabbath, because this chapter is also going to detail... what do you call them? I guess... the earth cycles, summer, winter, fall, spring, the seasons and timing, but I'm not going to get into that. So let I continue. I'm going to start again from verse 3. And the waters returned from off the earth continually. And after the end of 150 days, the waters were abated. And the ark rested in the seventh month on the 17th day of the month, upon the mountains of Ararat. And the waters decreased continually until the 10th month. In the 10th month of the first day of the month were the tops of the mountains seen. And it came to pass at the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made. Verse 7. And he sent forth a raven, which went forth to and fro until the waters were dried up from off the earth. The raven. I want to speak on the raven. The raven is a, is that word connects to like, to the Arab, like, and to our nowadays problem, the trafficking and making possession of oneself. Give me just 1 second to... to exchange... and to... the trafficking, the moving, the... it went to and from. And so... the trafficking of, like, I guess... hold on. And exchanging the merchants. The raven is kind of like a type of merchant. And it's black, but the blackness does not necessarily mean color of the skin. You see, the black signifies the going away far, like becoming of great distance from anything. And in this case, the truth, they start going astray. And so, like Cain earlier in the scriptures, he is to become a vagabond in the world, to a wanderer, just to and from, basically just causing problems, you could say. And so, because they're just wandering and lost with no direction, they start falling away from the light, and they become white lepers, white as snow. I could give an explanation for that, in the sense that, what does white, the actual color, the frequency white, what does it do? It reflects all color. It rejects all color. Light tries to get into white, and white just totally rejects it, reflects it away, like, get away from eye. And so that's interesting, because for example, if I live in a hot place, and if you want a cooler car, you get a white car, because it's gonna reflect the rays of the sun. And what people don't do down here in the valley is get black cars, because black cars absorb, they intake all frequency, all light. So you could kind of put that into perspective and apply it to this teaching right here, and realize that black isn't as dark as it may be, I guess, described as. So let us continue. Oh, also, this is going to begin this is like related to the parable of the sower. Because Noah opened the window of the ark, and he sent forth a raven. This could be like the worldly seed. Now continuing, verse 8. Also he sent forth a dove from him, to see if the waters were abated from off the face of the ground. To see if the troubles, if the troubles were I guess, decreased from off the face being the pineal gland of the ground. And the ground would be I and I, in a sense. Okay, that's kind of confusing. Let me continue before, I guess I'll explain it a little better. Now, verse 9, but the dove found no rest for the sole of her foot, and she returned to him into the ark, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth. Then he put forth his hand and took her and pulled her in into him, into the ark. Now, this could be another seed that's been sown. First of all, the spirit comes like a dove. So this seed is looking for good ground on the face of the earth, but it found none. It found no rest. Like Wendem Yadon has been saying, come to me, those that are heavy laden with those that have to carry a heavy burden, and I will give thy rest. Now the spirit, the dove, came back to Noah, and Noah stretched forth his hands and pulled the dove in. So this could be a kind of like a interpretation of the dove had no rest for her soul. And the comfort of Noah within the ark provided that rest for the dove. And interesting to note as well is Jah is not here to soothe the physical. Oh no. Jah will soothe the soul. He will give rest to I and I. And I interpret this little section to kind of like, this is the way I interpret this section of scripture. And one second. Okay, I have an actual image I'd like to share. Sorry. Okay, I guess I'll explain this in a little while. I don't know how well you can see this. I hope well. Okay, I hope you can see it well. This is Earth, and then this is the Earth is the footstool of Jah, Rastafari, correct? Now, his feet are on the vessel. Well, you know, when Jesus Christos gets into the boat, he at one point sits, right? Because he's resting. And everyone else is standing. Because he's been provided with, he's in the ark. He's been provided with rest for his feet, for his soul. The soul of his feet. And the soul of his feet could be I, heart and mind. In the sense that if the earth is His Majesty's footstool, and he's sitting, and you could see this is the ark right here. And if we were to again place the man in the center standing up, the radius again would link to the center chakra and providing rest in the heart. And I'll further discuss this when it's time. I mean, it's not the best drawing or anything, but just to expand. Now, verse 10. And he stayed yet other 7 days, and again he sent forth the dove out of the ark. And the dove came into him the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf pluck, okay, I'm going to do it again. Verse 11, and the dove came into him in the evening, and lo, her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. In her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off. Noah knew that the waters were abated from off the earth. Now, olive, representing oil, the opening of the mouth, the loosening of the seals, the ability to hear, to see, to taste, to feel, that Jesus Christos provided for many, and I. And this also is representing that there is now, this is kind of like spring. No longer are the waters covering the whole earth. Now there's actually sprouting of fruit. And this could also be interpreted as another seed being sown. I'll be honest, I could be wrong, but because there's four of these events and we'll get into it, but to be honest, I wouldn't know which one to locate where, but it relates, I'm sure. Now, verse 12, and he stayed yet another 7 days and sent forth the dove, which returned not again to him anymore. And it came to pass in the 601st year, in the first month, the first day of the month, the waters were dried up from off the earth. Now this dove didn't come back. Maybe it's the one that, and the spirit of Jah came to Jesus and stayed upon him. And so this is also, I think this is speaking on April. This is indicating the month of April, springtime. Now, verse 14. And in the second month, on the 7th and 20th day of the month, was the earth dried. And Jah spoke to Noah, saying, go forth of the ark, thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. Bring forth with thee every living thing that is with thee, of all flesh, both of fowl and of cattle, and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth, that they may breed abundantly in the earth, and be fruitful and multiply upon the earth. And Noah went forth, and his sons, and his wife, and his sons' wives with him, every beast, and every creeping thing, and every fowl, and whatsoever creepeth upon the earth. after their kind went forth out of the ark. And all built an altar to the Lord, and took of every clean beast and every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor. And the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake. For the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more everything living as I have done. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and the day and night shall come, shall not cease. Okay, this section right here, it's gonna play into effect when I go to the Exodus part of this series of videos, I guess. Because just keep in mind that the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Now, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. So once again, this cycle, it's cleaning, the baptism of the earth, you could say it's another cycle, and it's replenishing time. It's time to do away with the bad weeds, make room for the good ones. Now, chapter 9, and God bless, okay, verse 2. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered, all the fish in the sea. Okay, maybe it's time to throw in the rulers of the world, so-called Vatican. They work under this title, the Holy See, which is the holy seat, and they're fish, you know. They actually have no life in them. They have no blood. They have no life. And in fact, they consume blood. They're vampires. So, and this will all connect, like I said, with even the Sabbath studies today. But just keep in mind that they will be in fear of I and I. They're actually I and I dominion, as well as every creature and everything. Well, let I just continue before, I guess I'll explain that later. Every moving thing that liveth, okay. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require. At the hand of every beast will I require it. And at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of Jah made he man. And you, be ye fruitful, and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and multiply therein. And God spoke to Noah and his sons with him, saying, And I beheld, behold, I establish my covenant with you, and with your seed after you. So the covenant is only with the seed of, well, later on it's going to explain Shem, but with the good seed, with the seed of Noah for right now. Verse 10, and, oh, this is chapter 9 already, I think I said. Verse 10, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, of every beast on the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth, and I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off anymore by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. But now the flood is different. Now the flood is spiritual. Now it's this holy sea trying to control the earth. Well, claiming dominion over the earth. And I explained that later on. Now, and God said, this is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations, for on and on and on, the coming generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, Rastafari Ethiopian standard, which is also a sign, the standard of the tribe of Yehuda. Now, and it shall be for a token, for a sign, for a pass, like for a I guess to deliver, to gain access, to, you know, you want to get on the ride and you want to get on Zion train. Well, you got your token. You present that to redeem your pass over, you could say. Now, and it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth. Once again, we're not going to no longer be within the dominion of the Holy Sea. The floods will no longer, we will no longer be in the belly of the beast. Below waters. Now, and God said to Noah, this is a token of the covenant which I have established between me and all the flesh that is upon the earth, not upon the waters. And the son of Noah went forth of the ark. With Shem and Ham and Japheth. And Ham is the father of Canaan. These are the three sons of Noah. And of them was the whole earth overspread, the spreading out of the seed. And Noah began to be an husbandman, and he planted a vineyard. And he drank of the wine, and was drunken. And he was uncovered within his tent. This is the main part that I want to... get into. You see, I always tend to look at this section that is to come physically, but I've received a different interpretation, and I'm glad to be able to share with all the eyes, because it makes sense to I, you know. Go ahead and comment and let me know what any of the eyes think I should work on regarding the way I'm interpreting this, and what all of you think, so that we can better understand this. Now, here we go. So, Noah plants a vineyard, and he becomes drunken. There's something to that I forgot, to be honest. Well, let it continue. Verse 22, chapter 9. And he drank of the wine, and was drunken, and he was uncovered within his tent. For the Nazarite, well, we are not supposed to drink wine. For obvious reasons. What happens? Noah was uncovered. He was no longer under the protection of Jah, under the wings. He was he fell astray in the sense that he was drunken. He was he wasn't all there. He lost control, and he was discovered. He was some of the most sacred to Jah knowledge that Noah possessed was discovered, like someone got into it, taking advantage of that drunkenness. Now, within his tent, within his tabernacle, he's uncovered. This is kind of what's going on now. We're not covered by Jah, because we are being claimed, well, the Holy See is claiming dominion over I and I. We're uncovered. Jah redemption does not cover I and I within this system. We're not covered. We have to pay whatever debt we owe to the Vatican and the white supremacists, European monarchs that govern, the foreign powers that govern this land, and just to get an idea of what's going on a little more. And so he's not covered within his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brethren without. He saw the nakedness. Yes, maybe he did have something to do with Noah's wife, but look at it this way. There was, in fact, what we could say... Oh, okay. First of all, let me clear off the waters, that the waters were abated, that the heavy burden were made light. Like what I and I are going through. We're trying to separate ourselves from the world to make so that we can find rest in our souls and then through Jesus Christos via the Father, Haile Selassie. Now, there was unlawful intercourse with the wife, but if we accept the wife to be the mother, then the mother is the law. They discovered Noah. They got into the, like, this is what the judicial system, the all those lawyers and all of that, the liars, that's what they do. They've uncovered our covering, which is John, and they've found a way to within the mother. And they've had unlawful intercourse. They've intermingled and mixed the Arabs, you know. They've infiltrated our mother, which has led I and I to forsake our mother, and lose fear of our father, you could say. But this is what was uncovered. The uncovering the nakedness of a girl is also like the long hair, and then they if you could see, they pull the hair back so that someone can kind of whisper something in the ear. You know, it's kind of Noah's drunk, getting high on his own supply, you could say. And so he slips, and they uncover, like, a mystery. Like, something that wasn't supposed to be known, because this later causes this. Let us keep reading. This causes that, and Ham tells his brothers, right? And he told his brethren without, so he entered the tent to begin. He's in the tent, in the tabernacle. And then, and Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it upon their shoulders, and went backwards and covered the nakedness of their father. And their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. Okay, now remember, the nakedness is the glory of our Father, which is the Word and the law, in a sense. And they uncovered that. So they grab a garment and laid it upon their shoulders. So let me check the time. Okay, so they made to themselves Hold on. Gotta go to Exodus 20 real quick. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make to thee any graven image or of any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, and, you know, on and on. They made to themselves a covering, you know, because I guess this even ties into the tabernacle. The one of the coverings has no form, because Jah has no form, nothing that man would desire. And they put a garment, they made their own little thing, and they put it upon their shoulders, upon their shoulder blades, and they backstabbed Jah, you know, upon their wings, their shoulder wings and their shoulder blades, and they carried this like in the events of the golden calf, where they make to themselves this molten image of a calf or whatever, and they carry it on their shoulders and they're walking around with it because they're carrying the weight of this artificial god that they've created, They crossed the line, man. They backstabbed John. And they whitewashed it and everything. They put this white garment that like this goat, well, not goat skin, but anyway, they put this fake image, and now they started worshiping that and carrying the burden of what they've done. Now, also very important to note that they went backwards and uncovered the nakedness, the glory, the aura, the brightness, the shining of their father. Now the father was not visible, and their faces were backwards. No longer were the faces of the angels upon the ark face to face. Now they were going on opposite directions, and they're going backwards. So they're not going like the right way. They're not going through Jesus. They're taking this back way. And so back way with them wicked man, you know? Cause they're going astray. They're like the raven going to and from. They're going nowhere. And walking backwards. And what do all these religions do? They go contrary to the word, to the law, to the glory of His Majesty, you know? As for my part, I glory in Scripture. But there's been a veil, that covering, that garment placed upon it. Now, I'm sure there's a lot more to it. I'll leave that up to I and I. I know I'm missing a lot of detail, but it's what came to me now. So let I continue. By went backward and covered the nakedness of their father, and their faces were backward, and they saw not their father's nakedness. We could not see our mother, and so how can we be in-laws, you know? Well, and Noah awoke from his wine, and he knew what his younger son had done to him, and said, "Cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be to his brethren." And so on and so forth. Now, I just thought about this right now. It doesn't necessarily mean that everything that happens hereafter is in fact happening thereafter. But oh, never mind. I take that back. Okay, I'll stop right here, because pretty much all that I wanted to extract from these two chapters I've done already, and I've went way past the time I wanted to consume. So now, Shabbat Shalom, Sabbath Salam. I give thanks for all those taking their time to view this. And, you know, have a great Shabbat. What's left of it. I'll be right back.